Joshua chapter 5. Verse number 1, it says, "And it came to pass, when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until we were passed over, that their heart melted, neither was their spirit in them any more because of the children of Israel." Israel has just crossed the Jordan River. The last two chapters dealt with the details concerning that. And it was very disheartening, the Bible says, for the kings of the nations that lived in Canaan land. They had heard of the exploits of Israel's God, right? When the spies came to Rahab, Rahab was able to tell them, you know, we've heard about what your God has done for you to the other kings in the wilderness. We've heard about what God did to you and the Egyptians at the Red Sea. But now you have an event that's right on their border. How did this nation cross the Jordan River? You know, how did that happen? Well, we know it was by the miraculous power of God. But the flip side of that is that you have nations that lived in that land that now have an enemy that has crossed the river. There is no more barrier. There is no more wall, if you will, between these kings and Israel that they know is coming to occupy this land. And to know what their God has done for them, their God has now parted two different bodies of water to allow them to cross. It's obvious that if there is nothing in nature that can stop the God of the Israelites, there's nothing these kings are going to be able to do. Now, they'll fight, and they'll try their hardest, but it's just so disheartening, the Bible says, for them. They're afraid, their heart's melted, neither was there any spirit in them anymore. You know, eventually, you just wonder, well, what in the world are we going to be able to do? If these guys can cross Red Sea and the Jordan and there's no kings in the wilderness that stop them, what are we going to be able to do? So Israel has crossed the Jordan. It's now time for them to occupy the land. But of course, there's a couple of things that need to be addressed before they can start any battles. And a lot of these have to deal with testing the faith and obedience of the children of Israel. Okay? So let's get into those tonight. Number one, let's talk about the circumcision. Okay, the circumcision. Let's begin with verse 2. It says, "And at that time the Lord said unto Joshua, make thee sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time. And Joshua made him sharp knives and circumcised the children of Israel at the hill of the foreskins." And this is the cause why Joshua did circumcise. All of the people that came out of Egypt that were males, even all the men of war, died in the wilderness, by the way, after they came out of Egypt. Now, all the people that came out were circumcised. But all the people that were born in the wilderness, by the way, as they came forth out of Egypt, them they had not circumcised. For the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people that were men of war which came out of Egypt were consumed, because they obeyed not the voice of the Lord, unto whom the Lord sware that he would not show them the land which the Lord sware unto their fathers that he would give us, a land that floweth with milk and honey. Joshua is commanded to take sharp stones and to circumcise the children of Israel, because there is an entire generation that didn't do this. That's why it mentions there in verse number 2 to circumcise them again the second time. It's not that individuals were circumcised twice, but there's obviously a gap in what you would say is the circumcision. You had an entire generation that was, and then you had an entire generation that was not. And the Lord tells Joshua to get this process, or to get this act restored. Okay, this needs to begin again right now. In the book of Genesis chapter 17, And I think when we were going through the book of Colossians, we mentioned some of these things briefly, but in Genesis chapter 17, we are told about circumcision and how that was given to Abraham as a token or a sign of the covenant that he had made with Abraham and ultimately would make with his sons, Isaac, Jacob, and the 12 tribes. Genesis 17, verse 9, it says, "And God said unto Abraham, Thou shalt keep my covenant, therefore, thou and thy seed after thee in their generations. This is my covenant, which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man-child among you shall be circumcised. And ye shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you. And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised among you, every man-child in your generations. He that is born in the house, or bought with the money of any stranger, which is not of thy seed, he that is born in thy house, and he that is bought with thy money, must needs be circumcised. And my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. And the uncircumcised man-child whose flesh of the foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant." So without getting into a lot of details as exactly what circumcision was, we'll say that it was the mark of the covenant. It says it was a token or a sign of the covenant. God gave the children of Israel something that would physically, okay, literally distinguish them as a people. He gave them a physical mark that would make them unique amongst all of the nations that inhabited that land and all of the surrounding lands. This was not something that people did. This was something that would be unique to Abraham, to his descendants that were given this covenant. Okay, so these children had a mark that physically identified them. But by the time you come to Joshua chapter 5, you learn that now there's actually been an entire generation that doesn't bear that mark. In other words, there's an entire generation that really doesn't even look like God's people anymore. They're not even physically resembling, they don't even physically bear the mark of the covenant. Now that is symbolic for us, right? The children that left Egypt were circumcised, but there was a generation in the wilderness that was not. You know, while the children of Israel were under the judgment of God, and that's not to say that God didn't provide for them in the wilderness. He certainly did. And they were certainly God's covenant people. But it doesn't take long to see and explain that while they were wandering in the wilderness, they were under the judgment of God. They were not able to inherit the land of promise as a punishment for their disobedience and their lack of faith at Kadesh Barnea. They were to wander for 40 years. And during that time under God's judgment, they didn't circumcise their children. So now Joshua has crossed the Red Sea, or the Jordan River, with a group of people that don't bear the mark that they're God's people. They don't bear the mark or the sign of the covenant. So in our text, in Joshua chapter 5, he says this, "Make thee sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time. This is the cause," verse 4, "all the people that came out of Egypt," it says in verse 5, "were circumcised, but all the people that were born in the wilderness by the way, as they came forth out of Egypt, them they had not circumcised." Now let's keep going with our reading. Joshua chapter 5, verse 7. Joshua 5, verse 7. "And their children, whom he raised up in their stead, them Joshua circumcised. For they were uncircumcised, because they had not circumcised them by the way. And it came to pass, when they had done circumcising all the people, that they abode in their places in the camp till they were whole. And the Lord said unto Joshua, This day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off you. Wherefore the name of this place is called Gilgal," or rolling, "unto this day." So as Joshua obeyed the voice of the Lord, and as the children obeyed the voice of Joshua, and the men were circumcised, we now have Israel having crossed the Jordan, ready to occupy the land, now ready to submit in obedience to God, now ready to occupy this land as a people that bear the mark that they are his. Right? They're going to bear that mark even physically in their bodies. Now let's note a few things about this circumcision here. In Colossians chapter 2, I'll start, of course, by making the spiritual application, because this would be the one that would apply to us. What was circumcision all about, right? What was the intent there? Well, it was to physically give the children of Israel a mark that would identify them, right? It was given to them to show them as physically a unique and different nation of people. It was to show that there was a group of people that God had set aside. There was a people that bore a mark that showed them as different. Now, that was what it was physically. But what about spiritually? What is it? What does circumcision mean for us? What does circumcision apply to us today? Well, in Colossians chapter 2, it says in verse 11, "In whom also ye are circumcised, with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ." What was circumcision? Well, in general, it was a mark on the body that identified them as a people, but there was actually a little more symbolism to it than that. It was symbolic in that there was a part of their flesh that they literally cut off, and that's symbolic, right? That's symbolic of putting off of the flesh, right? There's something that is new. There's something that's different about the children of Israel. They literally, physically, put off a part of their body. We are told spiritually to do the same. Or we're told that spiritually the same thing has been done to us. Again, Colossians 2:11, "In whom also ye are circumcised, with a circumcision made without hands." This is not something we physically did to ourselves in our body, but in verse 11, "in putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh." In Ephesians chapter 4, in verse 22, we are told that ye put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. You know what we're told to do? We are told to put off the old man, right? The old flesh. Just as symbolically Israel was to physically cut off a part of their flesh, we are told spiritually, we are told as new creatures in Christ Jesus, to put off the old man, to put off the old flesh, right? It's not necessarily something that we're doing physically as much as we're talking about our old nature, right? The old man. We should not live according to the flesh any longer. If we be risen with Christ, if we are indeed new creatures, we should be walking after the Spirit, Galatians says, and not after the flesh. Now turn to Deuteronomy chapter 10. While circumcision was given as a physical thing, it was always intended to be spiritual. It was always intended to be a symbolic gesture. And Israel at times missed that. In Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse number 16, it says, "Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart, and be no more stiff-necked." In Jeremiah chapter 4, Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse number 3. Jeremiah 4:3, "For thus saith the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up the fallow ground and sow not among thorns. Circumcise yourselves to the Lord and take away the foreskins of your heart. Ye men of Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my fury come forth like fire and burn that none can quench it, because of the evil of your doings. This same chapter, verse 14, obviously continuing on with that symbolic thought, verse 14 says, O Jerusalem, wash thine heart from wickedness, that thou mayest be saved. So obviously in making spiritual application, right? The children of Israel are not bearing the mark that they are the children of God, right? That they are God's covenant people. And Joshua is going to restore that. Okay, that's the first thing. As they have crossed this river and they are getting ready to occupy this land, guys, we've got to restore that mark. We have to identify ourselves as God's people. Right now, we don't even look the part, right? We're not even bearing in our own bodies the mark that God set apart for us to be identified with. Right? We as believers, right? All of those things spiritually would still apply to us. If we're going to walk after Christ, we should not walk after the flesh. We should actually put off the old man, the Bible says. We should be circumcised in our hearts, putting away the body of sins, Colossians chapter 2, verse says. There's actually a symbolic act that we did that's kind of a sister to that. Now, sometimes people get confused and try to overlap too much circumcision with baptism, but that is actually a symbolic act that we went through. And do you know what baptism symbolized? That we were dead with Christ, that the old man is dead and buried, and that we were raised to walk in newness of life. Look what it says in Romans chapter 6. We're careful not to use the same language, right? We would not go as far and use specific language in all ways. Like, I wouldn't necessarily say that baptism is a mark of a covenant, you know, like we would say that circumcision specifically was. But Paul tells us in Romans chapter 6 and verse 3, know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Right? Just as there was a physical act that they had, you know, it's interesting to note that we actually went through an act that, you know, was a testimony and a commitment that, you know what, our faith and our trust is in Jesus Christ. And just as he died and just as he was buried and he rose again, that is what has happened to our old man, okay? We are dead to the old man. That commitment is to no longer live after the flesh or live after the old man, but to raise and walk in newness of life. It shouldn't be a stretch for people that have claimed to know Christ and have been baptized to know that that was a commitment. That was a public testimony and commitment that you were going to put off the flesh and walk in newness of life, right? So that's the spiritual application. And Joshua wants them, before they ever occupy this land, he is told by God to restore this mark. These people need to look like my people, right? Now, let me say something else about that. This would have hurt, right? This would have hurt them physically. We're given an example in Genesis chapter 34. And we don't have time to read that entire chapter, so I'll give you the highlights there. The 12 sons of Jacob actually had a sister. Her name was Dinah, and we learned that in this passage of Scripture, she had been defiled by the men of Shechem. The children of Israel, the 12 sons, actually, as they were at this time, a couple of them, specifically Simeon and Levi, want to get some revenge for them defiling their sister, so they trick the men of Shechem. You know, they act like they're going to get into a covenant with them. Genesis 34, verse 14 says, and they said unto them, we cannot do this thing to give our sister to one that's uncircumcised, for that were a reproach unto us. But in this we consent unto you, if ye will be as we be, that every male of you be circumcised. Then will we give our daughters unto you, and we will take your daughters to us, and we will dwell with you, and we will become one people. In other words, they say, hey, listen, we can't just intermarry with you guys. You guys aren't circumcised, and that would be a reproach to us. But if you guys will promise to be circumcised, then everything will be okay. We'll exchange our daughters with your sons and vice versa. We can all live happily together and be one people. You actually learn in this passage that they were tricking them, okay? The children of Israel, Simeon and Levi, were being deceptive. And here's why. It says in verse 22, only herein will the men consent for us to dwell with us, to be one people, if every male among us be circumcised as they are circumcised. Shall not their cattle and their substance and every beast of theirs be ours? Only let us consent unto them, and they will dwell with us. The men of Shechem, they all get together and talk and say, I think we should do this. You know, this seems like a beneficial transaction for us. And unto Hamor went, and unto Hamor and unto Shechem, his son hearkened. And all that went out of his gate, and every male was circumcised, all that went out of the gate of his city. And it came to pass on the third day, when they were sore, that two of the sons of Jacob, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brethren, took each man his sword and came upon the city boldly and slew all the males. This was a trick because Simeon and Levi knew that if these men were circumcised, they would be in physical pain for days and not be able to protect themselves, right? As an adult, going through the process of circumcision was going to hurt. It was going to hurt the children of Israel in Joshua chapter 5. You know, sometimes getting right or making things right, it stings. You know, they have gone for a generation now without bearing the mark of who they were. And it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt to get back on track. Here's something else about that. It was going to take a little bit of faith. You know, if you're going to be incapacitated for a few days, maybe you should have done this on the other side of Jordan before you crossed over, right? Now you're in enemy territory, and now you're going to be incapacitated for a few days. You know what that's going to take? That's going to take faith. Doing this after you cross the Jordan means you're going to have to rely on God to protect you, because you're not going to be able to protect yourself for several days. Obedience often takes faith. There's no misunderstanding about it. Obedience is not always easy. It's not always painless. There are times that it hurts. There are times that it takes faith. But obedience is always the right thing to do. And the children of Israel need to go into this land. You know, God is going to use them in this land as a testimony, as his people, right? They need to bear the mark. They need to bear the marks that they are his. And that's what we need to bear, right? In our lives, in our world, we need to bear the marks that we are the children of God. You know, if we're going to attempt to reach this world, to reach the not just the country, but even down specifically to the region in which we live, we want to bear the marks that we're God's children. Now, we don't bear that mark physically in our body. We do bear that mark by the name that we claim, by our claim to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Christ has given us a way to distinguish ourselves as his people, right? How are people going to know that we're his disciples? First of all, it tells us that we'll know him. Brother John's just been teaching us through this, right? They'll know that we're his by the love that we have for them and for each other. Of course, it doesn't neglect to mention love without saying that if you love me, keep my commandments. We have ways, right, of distinguishing ourselves as God's people. You know, just as Israel could do so physically in their body, we know that in the day and age in which we live, we have opportunity to distinguish ourselves as Christ's people, right? And let's face it, honestly, in today's day and age, it's not even, hard's not the right word, but I think you'll understand if I pursue it that way. It's not that hard, right? If we love each other and if we obey Christ's commandments, we're going to stand out. we're going to be a unique people. So let's pursue on to that. And I like what it says there at the end of the passage. This day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off you. They have bore a reproach for 40 years. Think of the great high that these children were on when they crossed the Red Sea and Egypt was destroyed, right? There would have been no greater high for the children of Israel than to get to that point. And then immediately they lapsed in their faith. That lapse of faith culminated at Kadesh Barnea when they would not possess the land, when they would not trust God and believe God to occupy it. And now they have bore a reproach for the last 40 years. Today is the day. They look like God's people again. God has proven himself through another parting of the water example. And today is the day, he says, I'm going to take the reproach away. Today is the day they'll be able to be shown as my people, and they'll be able to start the process of taking this land back. All right, the circumcision. Number two, the Passover. It says in verse 10, and the children of Israel encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at even in the plains of Jericho. Interesting, they are given an opportunity, right? They cross the land, they see God's hand working, they're given a great miracle, a sign of God's presence and of God's power in crossing the Jordan River. They submit to circumcision, that first act of obedience and in identifying themselves as God's people, now again bearing the mark of the covenant. And wouldn't you know it, in this commitment or recommitment to the faith, they're given an opportunity right off the bat to obey God. Because guess what today is? Well, what did Joshua chapter 4, verse 19 say? Joshua 4, 19 says, and the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month. Do you guys remember what happens on the 10th day of the first month? Well, let's go to Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. Verse 3. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. Their calendar was reset in Exodus chapter 12, right? The first month, the 10th day of the first month was actually the day that they selected the lamb for the Passover. The 14th day was the day that that lamb was slaughtered, right? So began the Passover, and that was going to be followed by a 7-day feast of unleavened bread. The children of Israel, their feet came out of the waters of Jordan right in time to get ready to observe the Passover, right? Isn't it neat that, oftentimes a renewed commitment can be immediately tested by obedience, you know? And here we have this Passover. Are they going to observe it? And it looks like they're going to. Now, for 40 years, it doesn't look like they have been. Now, it says in Exodus 12, verse 48, let's do verse 48. Exodus 12, verse 48. When a stranger shall sojourn with thee and will keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, and then let him come near and keep it, and he shall be as one that is born in the land, for no uncircumcised person shall eat thereof. There was a prerequisite to even being able to observe the Passover. You know what it was? You had to be circumcised. Well, guess what? Nobody been circumcised for the last 40 years. We are told in Numbers chapter 9 that the first year after they came out of Egypt, they observed the Passover. But for those 40 years of wandering, they weren't even qualified to do it when they weren't circumcising their children. But as soon as they submit to obedience, as soon as they submit to a recommitment of their faith and they circumcise, guess what? Immediately it's time to observe this Passover. If they crossed the Jordan on the 10th day of the first month and they were all circumcised, then you can all see that right there in that same week, they were able to observe the Passover. This is a pretty big week, right? You imagine all in the same week, a crossing of the Jordan River, being circumcised, an entire generation of people, and observing the Passover, right? All at the same time. Not to mention, you kind of got some pretty big plans coming up, right? You're supposed to occupy an entire land. You know what? This is what lies in front of them right now. Big picture, yes, they're going to occupy this land. They're going to have to fight for it. They are going to have to pursue after the people of this land to win this land from them. But this week, right now, God said to be circumcised, and it's time to, we have to obey and observe the Passover. And the children of Israel did that, right? Obey. Whatever the next commandment is, obey it. What was right in front of the children of Israel? The 14th day of the first month. Obey and keep the Passover. And they did, okay? It would be a shame if they had just submitted to circumcision and immediately turned right around and didn't obey the Passover, right? Didn't observe that first of all, the all-important feasts. But it does say there that they encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at even in the plains of Jericho. The Passover was an important holiday for them. The Passover demonstrated that God had once put a difference between them and Egypt, and that God had saved them and protected them behind the shed blood of the sacrificed lamb. Okay? That was a lesson for them then and a lesson for all future generations and the Messiah to look forward to. And now they have obeyed. So chapter 5 starting off is a really good chapter, right? Circumcision, they obey and keep the Passover. Number 3, lastly, let's talk about the corn. The corn. It says here in verse 11, and they did eat of the old corn of the land on the morrow, after the Passover, unleavened cakes and parched corn in the selfsame day. And the manna ceased on the morrow after they'd eaten of the old corn of the land. Neither had the children of Israel manna any more, but they did eat of the fruit of the land of Canaan that year. This is another pretty big event, right? Something changed. Now, we had seen this before, right? Something else had changed. Earlier in one of these chapters, we looked at how the Lord was going to lead them. And he led them by the priest carrying the ark, right? Previously, the Lord had led them by pillar of cloud and pillar of fire. Nope, that not anymore. That was during the wilderness. Things have changed. Here's something else that changed. Something that they had seen for the last 40 years wasn't going to happen anymore. The manna, right? Remember back in Exodus chapter 16 when the children of Israel didn't have any food and the Lord provided them with manna from heaven? And he has provided that for them every day except the Sabbath day for the last 40 years. And even when on the day that he didn't provide it, he provided twice as much the previous day so that they'd always have enough. You know, there are stories of what's going on with the children of Israel in the wilderness. Did you know that not every time a story is mentioned, not every time a historical event is mentioned, does it mention, oh, by the way, God gave them manna that selfsame day. You know, this is just something that we know God did for them every single day. And it's not written about every single time, and it's not mentioned every single time that a significant historical event happens. But every single day for the last 40 years, the children of Israel have been provided for by God. He has given them food. And now they've occupied the land. They have come across the Jordan River and are physically in this land. And you know what they're able to do? They're able to eat of the corn in that land. And so what does it say in verse number 12? The manna ceased on the morrow. Do you know when the manna ceased? When God had brought them into the land that he had promised them. They still never ran out of food, right? They have, now they're in the land, a land that flows with milk and honey, a land where they are able to eat this corn, and now the Lord stops providing the manna. That's a significant event. You know, the children of Israel had been provided for every single day. There is a generation now that is alive that every day of their lives they have seen and had a testimony of God's providing for them. That was important. That was something that they would need to remind their children of, right? There is probably going to come a generation after that, or the generation that is just being born in this new land, they're not going to know anything about the manna unless it is told to them, right? But they now have a memorial of stones. They have a golden pot of manna that has been saved according to Exodus chapter 16. There are lessons that they can teach their young people about how God had provided for them all along the way. Listen, the generation that is going to be born now is not going to have to go and collect manna. They're not going to have to find it each day. They're not going to have to go outside and depend upon that each day. But it would be a shame if they would have forgotten that, right? So hopefully, you know, hopefully the memory of that lasted still for many generations. But the day the manna ceased was the day they were able to eat of the fruit of the land. God had provided for them every single step of the way. And only when he had fulfilled his promise to bring them into that land and allowed them to eat of that land did he stop the manna. There is no way that you could ever reasonably doubt the hand of God leading and providing the children of Israel through the wilderness. That was a time of judgment. It was a time of punishment. An entire generation had to die, right? We get that. We know that. They bore a reproach that had to be repealed, a reproach that had to be taken away. God never took away his love and providing for those children, even while they were under his judgment. So what a great day, right? When they were able to come into the land and eat of the corn, and they went out their tents the next morning, and you know what? There wasn't any manna on the ground. You say that's, you know, did they look at that as a loss? Well, I certainly hope not. I certainly hope they went out of their tents in the morning and they didn't see manna on the ground. They thought, it's because we're here. God brought us here. And now we're in the land. All right, let's close there. We'll finish up chapter 5 next week. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on us. We're thankful for how we can testify that you've provided for us every step of the way. Lord, we have seen highlights and points where our lives where things changed and the way that things were previous to that weren't that way anymore. Not because you stopped providing for us at all, but Lord, but because it became different. It came in a different way. You've helped us achieve goals and reach milestones, reach important points in our lives. I pray that each step of the way and through each milestone that you brought us, through each great thing that you've done in our lives, you've given us something that we can teach others. You've given us something that we can share with the generations that follow, the next ones that come. There may be a generation that doesn't see physically how you've provided for us and our generations. But Lord, we have stories to tell. We have things that we can teach them about what you've done for us and how you have protected and provided for us each step of the way. I pray, Lord, that as we seek to establish a work here and as we seek to teach not just our young people, but as we seek to teach young Christians, Lord, that they could be established in the faith and in simple obedience to you. We're thankful for the testimony of this passage, and how the children of Israel were able to leave the reproach of the wilderness behind, identify as your people, again bear your mark, and again show who they were. I pray, Lord, that you help us to put off the sins of the flesh. Help us to put off the old man. And as we live in this world, help us to look like your people. Help us to act like your people. Help us to live so that there is a distinguishing, not because we want to attract attention to ourselves or glory to ourselves, but because we want it to open up opportunities to share the Christ that has made us different. And so, Lord, I pray that you give us those opportunities. Help us to live for you in this world. Please help us to set aside the sin that does so easily beset us and pursue on to follow you each day. Thankful for this place that we have. Thankful for John and Ty and their leadership here. I pray, Lord, that you'll bless them and their family. Pray, Lord, that you help us to pursue after Christ, to follow him, to be obedient to your word, and help us to make a difference in the world in which we live. Thankful for the truth of your word, the testimony of your people of ages gone by. We're thankful for the examples that we see in the children of Israel, and as they prepare to occupy this land, that we'll learn more about what it means to live by faith, to live in courageous faithfulness and obedience to you. We're thankful for the good testimony and example of Joshua. Help us to learn, and bless us all. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, Brother John.